It's been 4 years and Apple finally announced the redesigned MacBook Air with a ton of updates and changes at its 2022 WWDC event. They showed it off and gave us some key specs, but there's still a lot of things that they conveniently didn't mention, both good, bad, and disappointing. In this video, I'm not just going to rehash the event like many people do, but provide some key insights that you likely won't hear anywhere else after this launch, so make sure to watch the whole thing. Of course, we're gonna be buying it. Actually, we're gonna get multiple configurations, and we're gonna share real-world detailed testing and comparisons. Now, we'll also be putting out a buyer's guide on the specific upgrades that are worth buying and what you should avoid, so make sure to click that subscribe button down below, and with that, you can help us reach our goal of 1 million subscribers. We are so close. The new M2 MacBook Air redesign is based off of the 14 and 16 inch MacBook Pros, and we have four color options: silver, space gray, just like before, as well as the new starlight and midnight colors, just like you get with the Apple Watch Series 7 and the iPhone 13. Personally, I am disappointed that gold is gone. It was by far my favorite color, not only for MacBooks, but also for iPhones and the Apple Watch, so it sucks that it's gone, and the new starlight is more of a warm champagne color, kind of a mix of silver and rose gold. Now, I'm not a fan at all, and I would rather just have gold in, or maybe just even get the silver one instead, but you guys let me know your thoughts down in the comments section below. Now, I like the midnight color a lot more. It kind of can look like black under certain lighting, but it's a deep navy blue. It's basically kind of like a darker space gray, but with a slight blue tint. A lot of people have been asking for a black MacBook, and I don't know if Apple will ever offer that, but this is the closest that we've ever gotten. I'm a fan, and I'll be ordering this one, but you guys let me know your thoughts down below. As for the design, for the first time ever, the Air doesn't have a MacBook Air name on the display chin, just like the new MacBook Pros don't, but what's interesting is that unlike those that instead have the logo on the bottom, this one has a completely flat, smooth bottom, so it literally has no MacBook Air branding on it at all. As far as connections, we have the headphone jack still on the right side, but now it's support for higher end headphones, and two USB Type-C ports on the left with a new MagSafe 3 connector as well that comes with color matching cables and plugs, unlike the 16 inch MacBook Pros where you still got a silver cable with the space gray model. Now for the first set of disappointing things that they didn't mention. They showed off the MagSafe connection and the ability to fast charge 50% in 30 minutes while audibly saying that you will need an available 67 watt power adapter, but when showing off the really cool 35 watt dual USB Type-C port compact adapter, they didn't say that you will have to pay extra for that. Why not ditch the old 30 watt adapter altogether and give us this compact one in the box, which can modulate power between two devices for maximum charging speed? Well, that is because Apple wants to maximize their profits, and they will charge you an extra $20 to get this new charger. Now, thankfully, they do give you tips on how to get it as a free upgrade, but you'll have to buy the $1,500 model to get it. Now, the next thing is even more disappointing because you can't just pay 20 bucks to fix it, and that is the performance of the ports. Apple's latest Macs have come with Thunderbolt 4, which is more powerful, but looking at the key specs after the WWDC event, we see that this 2022 MacBook Air comes with the same Thunderbolt 3 ports that the M1 MacBook Air came with, and not Thunderbolt 4 like the 14 and 16 inch MacBook Pros, along with the Mac Studio. Now, we'll see if these two ports have separate controllers when we get them, so make sure to enable those notifications, but for most people, what will matter is the biggest limitation that Apple didn't talk about, and that is only support for one external display. Yes, probably the biggest complaint is still there, and we now know that it wasn't just a limitation of Apple's first Apple Silicon chip, the M1, but an intentional choice to force people to spend more money and buy a 14-inch MacBook Pro for $2,000 if they want to connect to more than one display, and that is a big bummer. Of course, you could use an external adapter or docks like Anker's new one that gives support for up to three displays. I'll go ahead and link it down below in the description so you guys can check it out. The included display is a slightly larger 13.6 inch screen, so the new notch isn't technically wasting any space, but you actually get a little bit more, and it's now 25% brighter at 500 nits instead of 400, so you no longer lose out on brightness compared to the MacBook Pro. We also have the way better 1080p webcam from the high-end MacBook Pros, which is a big upgrade, but you can make it even better by using your iPhone on your MacBook. As you can see, we do have black bezels instead of the long leaked white ones. Let me know below if you're happy that they went with black ones or if you wish they would have the off-white ones from the 24-inch iMac. Now, even though this looks like a 14-inch MacBook Pro, we do have some differences. We no longer have speaker cutouts on the sides of the keyboards, but instead the speakers are hidden above the keyboard. Apple has done this before with the Retina MacBook and it still sounded good, and they say that these speakers are better than the M1 Airs, which they definitely will be because we have four speakers instead of two. Now, one thing they didn't mention is if these are dedicated deep woofers. Now, we have to assume so because there are two larger drivers, but on their website, they only list four speakers, whereas the 14 and 16 inch models specifically list high fidelity speakers with woofers. In the video, the bottom speakers are much larger, and of course they do have to produce bass, but this could just mean that they won't have that rich and deep bass that the better MacBook Pros have. Now, that is totally fine. We'll just have to see how much of an upgrade this is in our upcoming M1 versus M2 MacBook Air comparison. Now, you would think that they got rid of the speaker grille because of the smaller size and weight. Apple mentioned a 20% reduction in volume compared to the M1 model, but what they didn't say is that the footprint is actually now larger. Let me explain. The M2 model is thinner, coming in at only 0.44 inches thin. That is crazy thin, but they didn't say that the width is actually exactly the same. And in terms of depth, the new MacBook Air is actually longer than the previous one. So the 20% reduction in size is only because of the thinness. And that also helps with weight, coming in at 2.7 pounds instead of 2.8. Now, despite that, the battery has actually gotten bigger, coming in at 52.6 watt hours instead of 49.9, so just over 5% larger. Apple showed off 18 hours of video playback, which they test using the Apple TV app with downloaded content, but as far as wireless web usage, the site lists the same 15 hours as before. Now, that is interesting because the new M2 chip is more efficient, as they showed off on stage, and the four efficiency cores are a lot more powerful, which means that the performance ones will need to be used less often. Now, of course, real-world battery life could actually be better than the previous one. They also didn't mention that this new M2 chip didn't get any updates in terms of wireless connectivity, sticking with the same Bluetooth 5.0 and Wi-Fi 6, and a lot of people were hoping for updates to catch up with the competition with Wi-Fi 6E and better Bluetooth, but nope, we are not getting it here. But at least the new MacBook Air is now able to be configured up to 24 gigabytes of RAM for $200 more than the 16 gigabyte model. Now, they definitely could have done a 32 gigabyte configuration like some people asked for, but it seems like they are keeping that exclusive for the 14 inch lineup because even the M2 MacBook Pro can't get this option like the older Intel models could. We know that the redesigned MacBook Air costs $200 more than the M1 model, which is still being sold, but when they showed off the M2 chip with the 10-core graphics, they didn't mention that for the $200 price jump, you still don't get that 10 cores, but instead you get a binned 8-core model. To get the full 35% increase of graphics performance with the M2, you need to spend an additional $100 for the two extra graphics cores, bringing you up to $1,300, the same amount as the M2 MacBook Pro. Of course, the M2 Pro has that additional fan to make sure that you're having full performance with no slowdowns, and that's included for that $1,300. And also, it does come with that faster 67-watt charging for the fast charging. Now, we'll be doing an M2 MacBook Air versus an M2 MacBook Pro full comparison video, as well as a deep dive into the M2 chip, all the new improvements, and some of the other limitations. So if you guys wanna see that, make sure you guys click that subscribe button right above. Check out one of those great videos right over there. I'm super excited to be making more content on these machines and doing deep, very good testing for you guys. This has been Max, and I'll see you in the next video.